Peace be with you. Friends, it's a joy to welcome you to our online worship for this fifth Sunday after Pentecost. If you'd like to learn more about our parish and how you can make a gift to support our mission and ministry, please click on the links in the video description below. And don't forget to give us a thumbs up, to like this video, and to subscribe to our YouTube channel so you never miss any of our uploads. All that you need to participate in worship today is an open mind and heart, and, if you like, a Bible open to our gospel reading, which is Luke chapter 10, verses 25 to 37. Let's hear these holy words together. Just then a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" He answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus said to him, "You have given the right answer. Do this and you will live." But the lawyer, wanting to justify himself, asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers, who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend.' Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" He said, "The one who showed him mercy." Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." This is the gospel of Christ. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Friends, today the church appoints for us the wonderful parable of the Good Samaritan, one of Jesus's best loved and most widely known parables. This parable is rich in meaning and draws us deeply into the mystery of God's self-revelation in Jesus. The parable comes in a dialogue that Jesus is having with a lawyer, an expert in the law of Moses, who asks Jesus, testing him, what he must do to inherit eternal life. Jesus, as he so often does, answers the lawyer's question with a question. "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" And the lawyer answers, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." The classic answer, the correct answer. Jesus says to him, "You've given the right answer. Do this and you'll live." But the lawyer isn't satisfied. The scripture says he wanted to justify himself. In other words, he wanted to win the point. And so he asks our Lord, "And who is my neighbor?" And of course, Jesus offers him by way of response what we now call the parable of the Good Samaritan. Now, classically, this parable was read by the church fathers as revealing the whole sweep of salvation history from the fall to Christ's coming again. We see that right from the opening verse. A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho. Now, the road from Jerusalem to Jericho is literally a downward trek from the height of Mount Zion on down to the level of the Dead Sea. And so the man traveling this road down from the heights of the holy city to the depths of the valley of the shadow of death was Adam, the first man, meant to bring Adam to our minds, that is. The church father Origen of Alexandria relates the teaching of one whom he calls one of the elders, who said that here in this parable, Jerusalem was paradise, Jericho was the world, and the brigands were the enemy powers. The priest was the law, the Levite, the prophets, and the Samaritan, Christ. That is to say that this beloved parable, like all the parables of Jesus, ultimately reveals to us something more of God in Jesus Christ, something more of God's new creation in Christ, and the implications of that new creation for our own lives. And what are those implications here? Well, ultimately, it is the lawyer's question on which this parable hangs, isn't it? Who is my neighbor? Of course, for Jesus' audience, there was no such thing as a good Samaritan. For Jesus' fellow Jews, Samaritans were definitionally bad. They were those who had intermarried with the invader Assyrians centuries before and represented in their very beings a kind of perversion of God's plan for Israel. They were, to put it mildly, outsiders in the reckoning of Jesus' fellow Jews. But remember what Origen said he heard from one of the elders, and Origen was born in or around the year 185, so an elder's teaching in his reckoning is a very ancient teaching indeed. Do you remember what that teaching was, who the Samaritan is? The Samaritan here is Jesus. Jesus is, in his own reckoning, in his own teaching, the outsider. This makes him the outsider. And of course, it also makes Jesus the one who helps. And it means that that Samaritan, Jesus, is the one we should aspire to become like. And that identification of the Lord with the Samaritan means that this parable challenges entirely our notions of who's in and who's out. Who are the insiders? Who are the outsiders? Who indeed is our neighbor? Now, contrary to Jesus' first listeners, because of this parable, every Samaritan is a good Samaritan in our reckoning or the reckoning of the popular culture. When do we ever hear that term? When we talk about a good Samaritan, or perhaps there's a charity like Samaritan's Purse, kind of people who help. A good Samaritan is one who helps out at the scene of a traffic accident, or who holds a purse snatcher until the police come, or something like that. But there's a reason it's called the parable of the good Samaritan, because Samaritan, as I've said, was synonymous with bad as far as Jesus' fellow Jews were concerned. A good Samaritan was something remarkable, something almost inconceivable for the Jews of Israel. And yet, it is a Samaritan whom Jesus chooses to be the star of this parable, the one to illustrate what is a teaching of supreme importance, a teaching meant to inspire us to works of righteousness. The letter of James says, be doers of the word and not merely hearers who deceive themselves. And that, I think, is really applicable to our understanding of this parable. Now, why would Jesus talk in this way? Is he saying that what we believe isn't as important as how we behave? Well, maybe. But I don't believe that Jesus would say that how we believe isn't important. He would almost certainly say that our belief is of supreme importance, and that belief is meant to inspire us to works of righteousness. Okay, maybe that's the general moral sense in which this parable is often taken. You see somebody in the ditch, go and help them. Good, got it. But that doesn't cover the meaning in its entirety, not nearly. The lawyer's question and Jesus' answer don't quite match up, and that's part of the point. The lawyer wants to know who counts as neighbor. For him, God is the God of Israel, and neighbors are Jewish neighbors. For Jesus, Israel's God is the God of grace for the whole world, and a neighbor is anybody in need. Jesus' question at the end, which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers, isn't asking who the Samaritan regarded as his neighbor. He asks instead, who turned out to be the neighbor of the half-dead Jew lying in the road. Underneath the moral lesson, there's a much more serious question. Can you recognize the hated Samaritan as your neighbor? If you can't, you might be left for dead. The parable reminds us also that there are no bystanders in this life. We all know the right thing to do. We know deep in our hearts that we are all connected to one another as neighbors. The English bishop and scholar N.T. Wright, whom I'm fond of quoting, says that no church and no Christian can remain content with easy definitions which allow us to watch most of the world lying half dead in the road. No, indeed, we cannot. Jesus asked the lawyer, after reciting the parable about the Samaritan, which one of these acted like a neighbor? And the lawyer replied, the one who showed mercy. Jesus said, go and do likewise. My friends, this story and the parable, the story of this parable shows us exactly how being a neighbor works. The story may have ended, but it's not over. Go and do likewise. The rest of the story is up to us. And God bless you. Amen. Pray to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, saying, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Creator God, in love you have fashioned the human family in a variety of races, languages, and cultures. Do not let our diversity divide us, but help us to welcome gifts we can give and receive from one another. Save us from prejudice, arrogance, and fear, and teach us how to live together as members of one family, sharing one home, as the children of one God. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bless the homes in which your people live, O God, and strengthen the bonds of love between husband and wife, parent and child, sisters and brothers. Make our homes places of refuge and sources of strength, where we support and encourage each other. When conflict and tension arise, help us to work out our differences in honest dialogue, trusting that you will give us grace to forgive and strength to love in even the most difficult times. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, you have reconciled us in Christ Jesus and have given us the ministry of reconciliation. We pray for all those from whom we are estranged. Bring healing to strained or broken relationships. We pray with special intention for a spirit of reconciliation to be at the heart of relations between Indigenous and non-Indigenous peoples in this land. Forgive us for the times we have wronged others, whether by ignorance, neglect, or intention. Grant us the courage and the grace to transform unjust structures and to seek peace together. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is governed and sanctified, hear our prayers which we offer before you, before all of your faithful people, that in our vocation and ministry we may serve you in holiness and righteousness, to the glory of your name, through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.